repeated consecutively, and the number of times that they repeat differs between different people. So tandem repeats are interesting to study and traditionally have been difficult to analyze. We're interested in studying of tandem repeats in the context of human diseases, and they're known to cause a number of diseases with neurological phenotypes, such as Huntington's disease and ALS, which many people are familiar with. So specifically, we're interested in autism, which is an early onset developmental disorder, which is characterized by behavioral and communication deficits. Autism, like most complex traits, is influenced by the environment and has a strong genetic component. And we believe there could be about 600 genes that are associated with autism. Specifically, we're interested in looking at de novo mutations of tandem repeats, which could be expansions or contractions, which are found in the child's DNA, but not found in a parent's DNA. So our goal was to look at de novo tandem repeat mutations in a child by comparing their genome to their parents. And we hypothesized that these small mutational changes of tandem repeats play a large role in autism. So to do this, we worked specifically, we're able to gather whole genome sequencing data from the Safari consortium, which had over 1,000 families, and we had data from the father, the mother, the a child affected with autism, and a healthy child. And my goals of my dissertation research were to build a framework to identify new de novo tandem repeat mutations in these family large whole genome sequencing data sets. Then my goal was to examine patterns of de novo tandem repeat mutations that were in the healthy child and separately that were in the child affected by autism. Examining these patterns allowed me to understand the contribution of pathogenic tandem repeat mutations and how they might cause autism risk. So to do this, I built out a high throughput bioinformatics pipeline on AWS Cloud to process the whole genome sequencing data. And I spent a large portion of my dissertation research building out a pipeline and developing a method that I call MONSTER, which identified these new tandem repeat mutations. And that's a large part of bioinformatics research in general. Then I, after processing all our families, we were able to develop a resource, which is a database of tandem repeat genotypes in the mother and father and new de novo tandem repeat mutations in the children. And this resource allowed us to ask a lot of interesting questions. First, we were able to find over 175,000 high confidence de novo tandem repeat mutations across the genome. And we found that on average, there's about 54 de novo tandem repeat mutations per healthy child, which is likely an underestimate. So it's really interesting to think about how de novo tandem repeat mutations play a role in genomics in general, considering that they have a large proportion of de novo mutations in the general population. Then we compared the healthy child to the child with autism to see patterns of mutation between healthy children and children with autism and see areas in the genome that might be enriched for potentially being associated with autism. And so here, healthy siblings are in blue and they represent like the neutral background rate of de novo mutations. And the autism probands are indicated in red. And overall, we find that there's a genome-wide excess of mutations in autism children, where on average, autism children have about one more autosomal mutation than their unaffected siblings. And other areas that we saw that were enriched were the fetal brain promoter region, which makes sense considering regulatory regions are likely to be disrupted in autism, from which has been found from other studies as well. So understanding that all individuals in the general population have a baseline number of spontaneous mutations in their DNA, we wanted to know how we could filter out just general de novo mutations that occur to finding specifically pathogenic mutations that could be contributing to the risk of developing a disease. So one way to overcome this challenge in assessing variants is to look at de novo mutations in the context of natural selections, which allows us to develop a method to identify pathogenic mutations. And the main idea is that the most harmful variants will have adverse effects and reduce the fitness of a person, and therefore these harmful deleterious mutations will be selected against over time. And we developed a method called SISTER to be able to do this. So when we apply our method SISTER on our data set, we found that looking at the top 1% of pathogenic mutations, the relative risk of autism increases compared to looking at, in general, all de novo tandem repeat mutations. And when we further look at mutations that are to novel alleles that had not been observed in the control cohort, we found that de novo tandem repeat mutations are likely falling in genes that are known to be autism risk genes and also potentially indicating new autism risk genes. So this specific set of that I've highlighted here, this 35 most harmful de novo mutations are what we think might be most interesting. And I think it's interesting to note that we find both expansions and contractions to be in our top pathogenic mutation set. So we can see how tandem repeats have potentially varying roles when they are disrupted. And my work was published earlier this year online. So if you're interested in this work, you can read about it online. And I have a blog post as well that summarizes the work for a general audience. And so this work was done in collaboration with others from my lab and Professor Kirk Lohmuller from UCLA. So I wanted to thank Bonnie, who developed the SISTER method, Nima, who developed a gangster tandem repeat variant calling method, and also wanted to acknowledge others in my lab that have contributed ideas. And lastly, I'd like to thank and acknowledge the funding sources and research participants. I could take any questions if anyone has any questions.
Thank you, Ileena. Any questions for Ileena? All right, maybe I'll ask a question, Ileena. What are you doing next?
Well, in this work, I think there could be a lot of follow-up in expanding, looking at pathogenic tandem repeat mutations for other diseases. Specifically, it would be interesting to look at congenital diseases because especially for de novo mutations, they're more likely to occur in diseases that have earlier onset, like in childhood. Personally, I am working now at Illumina and I'm developing deep learning algorithms to be able to use machine learning in identifying pathogenic mutations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome. So if you have no other questions, let's move on. Thank you very much, Ileena.
Thank you.
Glad to have you today.
Thank you.
I'd like to introduce Andrey Bzikadze. He's a fourth year student working with Pavel Pevsner. And he's he works on many topics, including genome assembly. He's a member of the telomere to telomere consortium that is going to produce the first completed human genome including the more complex regions of the telomere and the centromere. And Andrey, take it from here, please.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much, Vineet, for this introduction. Let me just share the slides. Okay, so I'm a fourth year student in Pavel Pevsner's lab, and I'm working on human centromeres specifically, and that's what I'm gonna be talking about today. But I will start from saying that I know that some of you in the audience who work on the bioinformatics probably have used reference genome, human reference genome before. And even though it was introduced in 2001, and there's been 20 years progress since then, even now there are still gaps in this assembly. Those gaps are largely due to segmental duplications and long tandem repeats that are known to be the major source, that are known to be enriched for structural variants that are in turn known to be a major source of genetic diversity. Those SVs are associated with cancer and assault Mendelian and autoimmune disorders. So we'd really like to understand what is happening in those regions of the genome. In particular, what we're interested in Pavel's lab is the other centromeres. Centromeres are the regions of the genome where the system chromatids are connected. Their physical role is the placement of the kinetic orb when the chromosome segregation is happening. So really it is the place where during the cell division, the sister chromatids are being torn apart. So as you can imagine, if something goes wrong with those sequences, bad consequences can happen. There are genetic diseases that are associated with centromeres. Aneuploidy that arise during the meiosis can result in cancer and infertility. On the other hand, centromeres also present an evolutionary enigma. Even though they have a rather conservative function, conserved function is chromosome segregation, their sequence is not conserved at all. And even though that may sound surprising, but until recently, no human centromeres were assembled. So here I'd like to change gears a little bit and talk about the telomere to telomere consortium. So that consortium is an initiative it's a multi-university initiative of researchers that aims to provide the first complete assembly of a single human genome. We joined that consortium, and what we are dealing with is the other centromeres as a part of that. So before we go into the centromeres, I'd like to explain why it is so difficult from a technical standpoint to provide a first complete assembly, even though the initial assembly was generated 20 years ago. So here, I'm just gonna show you this plot. It's a graph. I'm not gonna go into the details how this graph is constructed. I'm just gonna say that the genome traverses this graph, and the vertices here correspond to 5,000 nucleotides, or letters, in the genome, and they have the genome traverses this, the genome actually has a walk through this graph. So if we start from the right side, here the edge labels correspond to the length of the corresponding edge and the multiplicity, the number of times the genome traverses this particular edge. So if you go here, the genome goes like this, and then it has to go through this edge two times, and it goes to the next edge. And you can kind of see how the genome has to be traversing the this graph. And more or less it is, you can see that this is a unique traversal until you get to the point here when you don't know how which edge to choose. Let's say we chose that one, then we go around and then we go to another edge. So even though this case shows you that this graph, the topology of this graph doesn't necessarily tell you how the genome has to be traversing, in more generally it still seems like a relatively simple graph. In most cases we can figure stuff out, okay? But it's actually just an example of centromere X. Let me show you an example of centromere 6. I'm not even bothering to show you the whole graph here. This is just a small snippet. And you can already see that there is an edge with multiplicity 40. So you can imagine the topology arguments would probably be very difficult to use here to understand how the genome traverses the graph. If you still have some hope that this can be solved simply, let me zoom out a little bit and show you a little bit bigger part of that graph. And that's where we're talking about that each vertex is a 5,000 base pairs. It is also important to remember that these plots were built on genomes that are already assembled by TTT consortium, and even they look complex. From the de novo, when we're doing de novo genome assembly, there is no genome available to us in advance. We have to do that from the reads. As some of you know, the reads can contain errors, and here we're dealing with 5,000 base pairs. So each time there is an error among those 5,000 members, we're gonna have problems in representing that as a graph. So that's why the problem took so long. However, when the long reads were introduced, they created a revolution in the genome assembly field. Oxford nanopore technologies allow to produce ultra-long reads, sometimes surpassing 1 megabase per in length. And they allowed the researchers, the telomere consortium, to generate assemblies of two complete gapless human chromosomes. Last year, it was X chromosome, and this year, just 3 weeks ago, it was the chromosome 8. Later, however, there was another revolution. There is another player in the field of long reads. It is specific biosciences, and in particular, hi-fi reads, high-fidelity reads. They allowed, together with ONT reads, they allowed the telomere consortium to announce the first complete human assembly. It's just in September last year, and there were only 5 gaps in that assembly that I can tell you now that will already have been resolved and will be presented very soon. However, even though Haikanu, an assembler from Hi-Fi Reads, was a workhorse for that effort, it still required a lot of manual effort and additional expertise to generate that assembly. Another hand of this, some kind of this gigantic project, is the Human Pangenome Reference Consortium that aims to generate the first pangenome, like a collective representation of several genomes, because humans are known to be quite variable in some parts of it, in some parts of the genome, and we need to represent this diversity. So because Pangenome Reference Consortium is more interested in streamlined assemblies of human genomes, they sometimes miss, they are not particularly interested in assembling very complex regions due to imperfections of assembly algorithms. We, on the other hand, care about things like regions like centromeres that are in particular ignored, largely unassembled by Pangenome Consortium. So we actually have our own, we're developing our own assembler for Hi-Fi reads, and here is the link to the preprint of that about this assembler. And if you're interested, you can check it out. It has been recently accepted to RECOMP 2021. I will be talking more about, I will return now to human centromeres and gonna talk about them and their place in the T2T effort. So just to tell you an idea of how the centromeres actually look like, they are not unlike the tandem repeats that Ileena was talking about. They're just much longer. Those are tandem repeats that can be as long as several megabase pairs. The units of those repeats are alpha sterilized. They're 171 base pair long, and consecutive monomers form high order repeats that are repeated thousands of times. The monomers inside the HOR are not very similar to each other. However, different HORs are very similar to each other. Sometimes they're identical. So we deal with this very long nested tandem repeats up to several megabase pairs long on each chromosome. So the first two tools that we developed there were the string decomposer and centrifly. I'll talk about string decomposer in a second. Let me start with centrifly. Centrifly was the first tool for assembly of human centromeres from ultra long error prone reads from nanopores. For T2T effort, it contributed the assembly of centromere X, centromere 6, and the validation of centromere 8. So just to briefly mention how centrifly works in a nutshell. We have the centromeric reads and the set of monomers, and we use this tool, string decomposer that I mentioned, to decompose the reads into the monoreads, right? Like then each read becomes this monoread where we decompose it in different blocks. And then we search for frequent substrings in those monoreads and build some kind of assembly graph. I'm not gonna go into detail how exactly we build the assembly graph, but it's important that we search for long and unique edges in this graph that ultimately allows us to assemble the centromeres. So here we have this graph. The blue edges are the long and unique edges. Here's on the right side again. We have the long and unique edges here. We search for long scaffolding monoreads that allows us to connect those edges. And the scaffolding results in the monocentromere. This is in a nutshell how centrifly works. Once we had those assemblies, we needed to generate the quality assessment. So we were faced with a challenge that there were no tools that would allow us to do that. So we developed tandem tools. In T2T consortium, we used for quality assessment of all centromere assemblies, all 23 of them, and also for assessment of other complicated regions. I'm gonna just give you an idea why this was difficult, is that usually you need to apply QAS. Some of you might have applied QAS before for your genome assemblies. However, it is not applicable for centromere sequences because QUAST relies on a reference given to it in advance. Here, we don't have a reference. We are generating the reference for the first time. So we need to rely on the reads themselves. For that, you need to map the reads to the assembly first to see if there are any discrepancies. But you can't do that because there are no mappers that will allow you to map the reads to the assembly that is essentially a long tandem repeat. So we developed the mapper that would allow us to do that confidently, and then the general set of metrics that would allow us to find discrepancies between assembly and the reads. And that led to incremental advancement of the assemblies in TTT consortium. So in the next steps for the centromere project for that was that once we had the validated assemblies, we wanted to detect and classify all alpha satellites, the monomers in the centromeres, and to decompose each satellite array into the HORs and classify them. We have already two papers coming for that. The first was just recently accepted to SMB and describes the tool Centromere Architect. And another tool called Hormone is an advancement over Centromere Architect. And we think that the bioarchive is going to probably will available in a couple of weeks for that. So after we have that, we will be able to finally compare the centromeres between individuals, uncover the evolution of centromeres, and be able to find the structural variants in centromeres that are associated with genetic diseases. I'd like to thank my collaborators from St. Petersburg University in Russia, in UC San Diego, and in TTT Consortium. And here are the links to our tools, those who are interested. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrey. That was a great talk. Any questions for Andrey? Maybe I can quickly ask one question. So your tools currently are all applied to haploid chromosomes or to diploid chromosomes?
That's a great question. They're all applied, most of them are applied to haploid chromosomes, except the Tandem tools that we've recently actually, now Tandem tools can map reads to diploid assemblies and pretty reliably. So it's according to our early benchmarks, it does not actually mess the regions, the read. So the read comes from haplotype A, we do not map it to haplotype B. So there, it seems to be pretty diploid aware. But apart from that, the genome assembly of diploid individuals still is a very, very urgent problem, right? The tool that I mentioned, HiFi Asm, that is the workhorse for the pangenome project, actually does not, it does not allow you to get assemblies of very complex regions like centromeres, deployed assemblies. Like it produces some assemblies, but it's difficult to tell if they're correct or not yet. So it's a major milestone.
Great. Thank you, Andrey. I think we should move on in the interest of time. So let me introduce Jens. Jens is working on extrachromosomal DNA, and he'll talk to us about a project involving viral cancers. Go ahead, Jens.
Great. Yeah. So I'm a graduate student in Vineet Bafna's lab, and I'm going to be talking about some of our research, which studies, as Vineet mentioned, a phenomenon called extrachromosomal DNA in the context of HPV-mediated oropharynx cancer. So this is a collaborative project that we have undertaken with a physician in the medical school at UCSD. And it's wonderful to be able to collaborate with those people because they generate some very cool data and have a lot of insight into the biology where we apply our computational tools. So to introduce this concept of extrachromosomal DNA, these are particles of DNA that have basically broken off of the linear chromosomes that Andrey was describing, and they've circularized, and they are implicated in cancer in the context that they will often carry, they're biased in favor of carrying genes that drive the aggressive nature of cancer. And also because they don't segregate evenly when cells divide, that is that they can randomly go into one cell or the other when a cell divides, they can accumulate in very high copy numbers. So this enables cancer cells to accumulate very high amounts of cancer-driving genes and also to evolve rapidly when faced with, you know, different chemotherapies and things like that. So we've been developing tools to actually study these extrachromosomal DNA particles in Vineet's lab. So I'm going to be talking about some of those tools. Namely, I think, you know, I'll just introduce the problem that we have here. So basically the standard for DNA sequencing in most contexts, especially in the clinic, is this short read Illumina whole genome sequencing. This is probably currently the most common form of DNA sequencing. However, it's relatively short. It doesn't tell us just in one DNA sequencing read the full structure of the ecDNA or whether ecDNA even exists. So we, you know, this outstanding problem was, can we build a tool that takes this kind of data and produces a prediction and characterization of ecDNA in cancer? And so we have, myself and others in Vineet's lab have worked on developing these computational methods to answer that problem. So basically the workflow to analyze ecDNA in cancers is basically that we take this whole genome sequencing data, we can align it back to a reference genome, and then we can identify regions of that genome where there are very many copies of certain pieces. This would be regions where we suspect that ecDNA may have formed, right? They can accumulate in very high copy number. So we identify those regions and then we feed them into a tool called Amplicon Architect. So Amplicon Architect is a tool which basically constructs a graph out of the rearranged genome where ecDNA and other types of focal amplifications can occur. So basically given, given these intervals where we think ecDNA might be, given the high copy number, Amplicon Architect will actually take the whole genome sequencing data and it will go through and it will look for rearrangements in the genome. And it will also measure the copy number of the genome in those regions. From this, then it constructs a graph, and using that graph, it will traverse through the graph and it will pull out some cycles or paths in this graph that represent kind of in an abstract way, they represent kind of possible structures for the ecDNA. And it tries to maximize this so that the most amount of the copy number is explained by these decompositions. So over the years, we've actually built a lot of tools that work in and around Amplicon Architect. So here we have Amplicon Architect kind of at the center of our kind of ecosystem of tools. But we've also built tools to standardize the preparation of data for this process, to standardize the classification of ecDNA in the resulting graph decompositions. Another member in Vineet's lab constructed a tool that actually takes microscopy images like those that you saw on the first slide of the presentation and counts the number of ecDNA present per cell, which is a very powerful kind of orthogonal way to detect ecDNA that doesn't involve sequencing. I recently built a tool which takes now both Oxford Nanopore and BioNano optical mapping. These are kind of long read, if you will, forms of genome analysis. And it will take that alongside our Amplicon Architect, and it will actually produce more refined structures for these complex rearranged extrachromosomal DNAs that can often be upwards of 10 megabase long. So, you know, if Illumina is giving us reads that are 150 megabase, we actually have to do a lot of work to try to pick out a structure that's so much longer. Recently, Siavash Decordi, who's in Vineet's lab, we worked together to develop a tool called Fandom, which will take this BioNano data and it will use, it will do its own alignment to help us resolve some of the more complex or harder to detect structural variants in the genome. And lastly, we've been working on, you know, doing some visualizations of the resulting rearranged genomes. So you'll see a couple of those in this presentation. And, you know, if you're interested in trying any of these tools, if you have cancer samples where you want to know if ecDNA is present, please, you know, feel free to check us out on GitHub. So where does HPV come in and what is the role of ecDNA? What is the relationship of ecDNA with HPV and cancer? So HPV is a DNA virus that basically that spread through sexual contact typically, and if there is damage to a mucous membrane, it is given a chance to infect kind of what's called the basal layer of the epithelium. And here it can live basically in these cells, and it has cells that are infected by HPV will actually go on to have a very high risk for turning into tumors. So it's thought that about 15% of the US population between ages 15 and 49 are infected with some form of HPV. However, HPV strain 16 is actually the one that's the most oncogenic. And that's not to say that everyone, all 15% have that oncogenic form. So the strain that we'll be looking at in this study is actually the relationship of HPV-16 to extrachromosomal DNA. So the HPV-16 genome is actually the circular DNA virus. It's already kind of interesting because the ecDNAs that we're studying typically are just circular human DNA. And so in this case, we have two types of circular DNA here, HPV and also human or human viral circular DNA. So there are, I won't go into all the different genes that are located on HPV, but there's a couple that I will draw your attention to, which are E6 and E7. And so these viral genes actually encode a protein which shuts down the activity of one of our primary tumor suppressor genes. So we have a gene called TP53, which basically its primary role is to detect damage to DNA and cause damaged cells to basically apoptose or do a programmed cell death. So these viral genes, E6 and E7, can actually shut that process off. So in our study, we're looking at a cohort of 72 patients. And in these patients, we have whole genome sequencing from the HPV-mediated oropharynx cancer. And we're able to categorize the different strain of HPV indicated in the cancer. So of course, as I mentioned, HPV-16 will be the dominant strain. We also have Illumina RNA-seq, so basically the product of DNA as it goes from DNA to protein. And we have that for the majority of the samples in this study, as well as this PacBio RNA isoseq, which is a long read RNA sequencing technology. So instead of those short Illumina reads for RNA, we get a much longer PacBio derived RNA seq. So that's also very helpful, but we have that only for a minority of the patients. So in this study, I want to point out a few interesting things that we find and how they kind of motivate our intuition to study ecDNA. So basically there are some what are called splice junctions in the HPV virus. So when RNA is transcribed from the DNA, it is often processed into things that the cellular machinery understands in a way that it can turn that RNA into a protein product. So the splicing is actually a very important part of efficiently producing protein. And in the viral genome, there are actually a number of splice sites that have clinical relevance, and we detect those in these cancers. So for instance, this SD226 to SA409 splicing connects to, basically cleaves out a piece of this gene E6. And in doing so, it creates a form of E6 that's much more potently oncogenic. And so we see that almost ubiquitously throughout the tumor samples in the first cohort here. We also see a splice pattern which connects basically this junction SD880 to SA3358. And this helps the HPV positive cancers to more efficiently produce this E7 element. Interestingly, we see a minority of patients, about one third, who have a splice junction from SD880, which is on the virus, into human DNA. And so the question is, you know, what does this mean for the cancers? And it's thought that basically the existence of splicing from viral DNA to human is another route by which E7 and E6 can be efficiently produced. But kind of the other question is, well, when this happens, there are these promoter elements that help initiate the production of that transcript. Are those somehow hijacked? Is there a selection for integration of the viral DNA into the human host genome in such a way that it will kind of drive a more aggressive cancer? It would be a very powerful strategy if the cancer did follow that, right? So we deployed our tool Amplicon Architect on these samples, and we were able to reconstruct, well, first I'll show you the unreconstructed, but we were able to examine these genome, basically graph structures that encoded the copy number and the breakpoints. And we see some very complex rearrangements. Some of them are very simple actually, which are just circular viral genomes, but with some non-canonical structural variation. We also see, as we've studied in our previous papers, human-only ecDNA, that is just, you know, human circular ecDNA, as we've already described in literature. But here we're also describing this phenomenon where we see hybrid ecDNA, which contains both human DNA and viral DNA together. And so these are particles of ecDNA that contain DNA from two different, you know, from a human and also from the HPV virus. So it's quite interesting to be able to observe. And the functional consequences, well, actually the existence of this has only been recently characterized, and the functional consequences of it are something that we're studying very closely, right? So we can actually overlay this information into our yes. Heatmaps of the splicing, and we see that actually there are some cancers where we observe both this splicing from the SD880 junction into human. And so that will be something that I'll revisit here. So I'll basically conclude by saying that we have observed the same phenomenon in an institutional cohort and also in a tumor database, which is TCGA, which is a famous cancer database. And that we see about 1/3 to 1/4 of HPV positive oropharyngeal cancer has circular extrachromosomal DNA of one form or the other. I'll also say that we are able to use our tools to put together putative structures for these extrachromosomal elements, and we're able to identify basically long transcripts derived from the entire circular extrachromosomal DNA using the PacBio isoseq long read RNA. And these help us to demonstrate the existence of human viral gene fusions. Our collaborator did a very wonderful experiment where he actually took these sequences that we found from the PacBio, and he cloned them into cancer cell lines. And we looked, and then he looked at how rapidly these cells would grow depending on the type of construct that was added. So some were just wild type genes, some were, you know, dummy constructs that didn't really have much of an effect. And basically, the take-home conclusion here is that actually the presence of viral and viral human transcripts, such as those found on the ecDNA, is significantly associated with an increase in cell proliferation. So, human ecDNA is a great driver of cancer aggressiveness, but also when human viral ecDNA exists, that is also a great driver of aggressive cancers. So. With that, I'd like to thank the collaborators, especially Joe Califano at the UCSD Med School and Paul Michel. I'm happy to take any questions if there's time. Thank you.
Thank you, Jens. I think we are actually out of time. So I'd just like to thank all the speakers first, and then everybody in the audience for being here. And we have the poster session next, and I don't want to take time from that. So I welcome you all to go and attend the poster session. And thank you again for coming. Bye-bye.